Hello and welcome to this new video. Today I will be talking a bit on how to configure any router or firewall. This is of course, I'm tempted to say not true, but the point I will be making is how to approach this. Configure any firewall, any router firewall. Because what you see when you start working with a lot of different devices, you will actually see that the basic setup is always the same, and then the different ones have different specific features or some specific something else, but the basics are always the same. So if we have subnet A, we have some device, and then we have subnet B, and this is the device that we want to configure. There will be something that all of them need. So if we are trying to allow going from A to B, and we perhaps need to do some NATing, or perhaps we need to do some port forwards, or we need to do some blocking. All of this is stuff you would ask yourself about any router you are to configure. So the first thing to ask yourself that you always must set up is that you must set it up as a normal network device. So basically point one is set IPs. IP, let's call it IP on interfaces. If this, the interfaces will be here on this drawing and here. That must, of course, be IP addresses associated with the proper subnet, and this one will be on the other side. This might be DHCP, doesn't matter, but the point is that you must know which interface is facing A, which interface is facing B, and you must set appropriate IP addresses on this. So if you are using Linux, you will be using IP address something. If you are on BSD, you will set hostname EM something. If you are on SIX, it's something else. And if you are on the Palo Alto, it's something else again. But basically, you must always set appropriate IP addresses on the interface. Otherwise, this device will simply not be accessible on the network. Okay. If this is a router, then I'm tempted to call it enable routing. For dedicated routers such as VSIX or Palo Alto devices, this is basically enabled by default. But if you try to work with a Linux machine or OpenBSD, you must actually manually set up that routing is enabled. It's something like sysctl and then IPv4.4. This is from memory. This would be on Linux. Something like this. So you will actually need to tell the kernel that it must be able to pass packages. So this would be IPs. And then you must tell it that it must be able to route. If you don't do this, it will simply not, if we look at the layers in the OSI model, then you will have, let's add a device here. This is some sort of client. If the client sends something, it will have its complete stack here. This would be 1, 2, 3, 4, up to 7. And over here, we'll have some sort of server, and it will also do something similar. Oh, that was very ugly. From 1 to 7. And then in the middle, we have the router. And the router has these three layers. Let's do it like that. So here you have some physical layer, you will have some data link, and you will have the network layer. So what you want to have happening is, let's pick some color. You have some application running on the client. It should do like this and up to the other one. But it requires that that this step here, that works. And that is, this would be where routing happens. So basically, moving stuff on layer 3 between interfaces, this is what routing is, and you must tell the kernel to be able to do that. Otherwise, the router will just receive it and say, it's not for my IP address, goodbye. Okay, and there is, and then we have the concept of, and now they start to differ the different devices. We, in some devices, we call them zones. So in this case, you will have, perhaps you will have untrust, and you will have trust. And then you will, of course, be allowing stuff going one way, but basically not going the other way, unless it's established already. So the idea about zones in the SIX and the Palo Alto, we have a lot of zones. On Linux, we will probably work with interfaces. CentOS uses zones also. BSD uses interfaces and interface groupings and so on. So there will be different wordings for zones. In most contexts, very often, especially for small networks, you will see that zones are basically the same as subnets, unless you start having very large heterogeneous networks where, you know, some Wi-Fi subnet will be the same as some cable subnet. Those two will be a zone, but otherwise it will normally be that each subnet is a zone for itself. So the so when you have established which zones you have and how to ship stuff left and right, this is something I mentioned in a previous video, you will be able to figure out how to actually set up zones on your given device and set up how to send stuff from one way to another. And then last but not least, since this is a firewall device, we will have some sort of port, IP, or content based block or allow. Block or deny. Oh, that's nice. Block or accept. All of these firewall systems will have some way of making rules that will allow or block that is different than the zones you have defined. So the this is the super high level view of configuring a router and firewall. So you must set IP. It doesn't matter which device you have. You must set the IP address. So, and this should also be part of your way of debugging these things. You must be able to see this. And then when you start working with these things, you actually, a Google search, Google it. I know it sounds simple when I say it, but how do I set an IP address on a specific interface in Linux? You will Google that and find a million hits, and all of them are good. The same goes for all the other devices. How do I enable routing in OpenBSD? This will be, when you have such a specific question, Google is your friend. Then you need to know a bit more about your device, if depending on if it's zones or interfaces it's working with. But then you can still define, how do I define a zone in VSIX? How do I define a zone in Palo Alto? How do I define how to what is allowed between zones? This will be very specific Google questions when you know that you are to ask for it. And this is the same. So how do I allow access to a specific device using the system we're actually having right now. So you need to step out of the very, very specific technical implementation and look at that you need to enable these things in order for it to work. So, and when you know you need to set this up, Google is your friend. Juniper have really good documentation. OpenBSD and Linux have really good documentation. A lot of people write about how to do these specific things. So when you know you have to do these specific things on this specific device you have, then it's easier. Then you actually will be able to Google it since you know what you're asking for. And again, this is basically all systems I've ever worked with. That was a quick primer on how to think when you are configuring routers. Oh yeah, there is one last comment I would like to make. And we can write it in capital letters down here. All devices have their own internal logic. And by this, I mean internal logic. And by this, I mean that all devices, whether it's Windows or Linux or BSD or Palo Alto device, they have a way that they have been, the designers have been thinking when they make the, when they have made the operating system or the device. So in order to be good at this, in order to be able to understand what people are writing, the trick is to crack the code on how they have been thinking. So in Palo Alto, for example, they are thinking a lot in objects. This is completely different than what we do in a Linux machine. So you must crack the internal logic of the device if you are to use it a lot. Just setting up that it's able to route, you can do that easily with quick Google searching. But if you are to crack the system, you need to spend more time on it and get some experience. Should we add a little crack it? Yes. That was what I wanted to say about configuring any router. Feel free to add any comments and ask for more in the comments.